Okinawa became, after World War II, one of the great military bastions in the Pacific. This is the harbor at Naha. Through these busy piers, past the armament that maintains our 8th Army in Korea. More recently, Okinawa has assumed an ever-increasing role in the logistical support of our many commitments throughout Southeast Asia. For this purpose, the 2nd Logistical Command was deployed to Okinawa from Fort Lee, Virginia. By using large-scale computers, thousands of daily transactions can be handled. Damaged vehicles are routed to the Mashinato service area for storage and repairs. Weapons of war are made useful again. The largest engines and transmissions are broken down and rebuilt. Electrical motors off our missile systems are carefully rewired in this, the only supply and maintenance complex in the Pacific authorized to do this work. Through this isolated pier, known as White Beach, millions of tons of explosives are offloaded for storage at the Shibana Ordnance Depot. Evidence of this massive stockpile can be seen all over the depot. Palletized bunkers house countless rounds of small arms ammunition. Propellant charges by the thousands fill these earth-covered igloos. Air-to-air and ground-to-air missiles are stacked in steel quonset-type storage magazines. Regular in-storage inspections aimed at maintaining a war-ready supply of materials dictates periodic renovations. Here, for example, old-type fuses are removed from 81-millimeter mortar shells. The new lot number and nomenclature is stenciled on, and the fuse head replaced. Before they are repacked in their canisters and boxed for further storage or outshipment, test rounds are brought to the artillery range for firing. From Okinawa to our fighting troops in Vietnam goes the assurance that the facilities, the materials, and the full support capabilities are on call and waiting to be used whenever and wherever needed. A United States Air Force plane rolls to a halt on a South Korean runway. It is 29 September, and high-ranking South Korean military commanders are present to greet General Harold K. Johnson, United States Army Chief of Staff. His arrival and his subsequent appearance at 2nd Infantry Division headquarters marks the beginning of 5 days of visits with United States troops and commanders in South Korea. At the conclusion of the ceremony, General Johnson personally greets many of the division's officers. Next in his itinerary is a visit to 7th Division headquarters. The United States has more than 40,000 servicemen on duty in South Korea, and General Johnson plans to visit and inspect as many Army units as possible. His round of visits includes Camp Carroll, where he is taken on a tour of the installation. After his inspection tour, Camp Carroll depot personnel stand formation as General Johnson troops the line. At Taegu the following day, the Chief of Staff arrives for a round of visits at the 8th Army Rear. Included is a call at headquarters of the United States 8th Army Depot Command. One of the highlights of General Johnson's tour is an air show given on 1 October in celebration of South Korea's 18th annual Armed Forces Day. Parachutists land on target, directly in front of the spectators. Climax of the show is an aerial firepower demonstration with rocket-firing planes attacking a mock enemy position. Next, a run is made with napalm. Again on target, right in front of the stand. The simulated attack moves to its climax. 9 aircraft come in over the target and obliterate it with napalm. Later that day, South Korean troops parade in Seoul before thousands of spectators, as well as military and government dignitaries, who include General Johnson and President Chung Hee Park. On the morning of October 12th, Secretary of the Army Stanley R. RESOR arrives in Heidelberg to begin 4 days of visits with U.S. troops and their commanders on duty in Germany. A 17-gun salute is given him by the men. He is met there by General Andrew P. O'Meara, Commander-in-Chief USAREAU, and together they attend review ceremonies at Campbell Barracks. For Secretary RESOR, this is his second USAREAU visit since he became the Army's civilian chief 15 months ago. This year, much of his time will be spent observing the withdrawal of men and equipment from bases in France. After trooping the line, Secretary RESOR and General O'Meara return to the stand, and the troops pass in review. Their tight schedule for the day includes a number of command briefings and, that afternoon, a visit to the river city of Worms and the men of the 8th Infantry. Next day, their motorcade crosses the Rhine to Kaiserslautern for an inspection of the group maintenance center at Panzerkasern. Secretary RESOR is taken on a 30-minute tour of the vehicle's rebuilding plant. Afterwards, the Secretary and General O'Meara will view installations near Mannheim before flying on to Bonn for courtesy calls on U.S. Ambassador George McGee and German officials. At a staging area in southern Denmark, 900 men of the 1st Battalion, 3rd Infantry Division, prepare to take part in Absalom 66, an integrated NATO field maneuver. Normally stationed at Schweinfurt, Germany, the battalion is taking the role of an aggressor force invading Denmark. Aggressor insignias are affixed to all the participating vehicles. At the appointed hour, the force, made up of more than 100 vehicles, starts to roll out. Designated Task Force 130, the convoy moves across the peaceful Danish countryside toward a rendezvous with an Allied aggressor unit from the Danish Army. In order not to damage the roads, the Danish tanks are actually mock-ups on 3/4-ton vehicles. The purpose of Absalom 66 is to provide realistic tactical training for Danish and American NATO units. It is named for a medieval Danish commander who repulsed a foreign force in the 12th century. Not far from the town of Næstved, the combined aggressor force reaches its deployment area. It's a strange sight for local school children who don't understand what's going on but enjoy it anyway. The men fan out and take positions to wait for the expected attack from the repulsing force, the Danish Guard Hussar Regiment. Here they come. The Americans open up with machine gun and rifle fire, and the battle is on. In the heat of combat, some men get a little carried away. The engagement goes on all afternoon until the Danes call for air support. With the help of their F-100s, the Hussar Regiment successfully repulses the aggressors. Soon after, however, the enemies are friends again as they march through the streets of Nesvet. The children still don't know what it's all about, but like kids everywhere, they love a parade. The 7th U.S. Army NCO Academy is located in Flint Kasern at Bad Tölz, Germany. The academy accommodates 410 students from all 7th Army and USAREAU units, as well as a few students from NATO countries. Under the command of Colonel Robert L. Moore, the four-week program of instruction entails courses in leadership, tactics, instructor training, and map reading. The mission of the academy is to develop the NCO to assume his responsibilities, gain the confidence to apply his knowledge, acquire leadership techniques, and maintain high personal and professional standards. For the instructor training phase of the course, students are given ample opportunity to instruct others. They conduct physical training, for example, in order to develop confidence in their ability to take charge, instruct, command, and correct a group of men. Learning by doing is a hallmark of the academy. Competence in map reading and the knowledge required to instruct in the subject is developed in a combination of classroom work and practical application in the field. The graduate of the academy will return to his unit with a better understanding and appreciation of the standards expected of a non-commissioned officer. Eglin Air Force Base, Florida. As part of Operation Safeside, some 67 Air Force officers and airmen are being given ranger training by the Army. Here, platoon leaders are briefed for a mission through guerrilla-infested territory and are shown their truck route. Ranger training is the first step in the program that will test the use of special security units to protect Air Force property overseas. Acting as guerrillas, Army troopers ambush the convoy. The airmen beat off the attack, but their vehicles are judged destroyed, and they must continue the mission on foot. This training in counter-guerrilla operations is the third and final phase of the Ranger course. Basic tactics, including hand-to-hand combat and bayonet fighting, are taught at Fort Benning, Georgia. Then, the trainees learn mountain patrol techniques in the Tennessee Valley Divide. Graduation for the airmen and Army troopers taking the course comes after 9 weeks of intensive training. The airmen, who are the first group of Air Force personnel to go through the Army Ranger School, are congratulated by Lieutenant General Glenn Martin, the Inspector General of the Air Force. These airmen will now form the cadre of the 1st Operation Safeside Unit to protect Air Force resources from attack and sabotage anywhere in the world. in seas still angry from the 175-mile-an-hour winds of Hurricane Inez, the U.S. aircraft carrier Boxer arrives at Barahona Peninsula in the Dominican Republic. Marine helicopters, summoned to assist in a joint U.S. military forces relief effort, fly over all that remains of this once thriving area 24 hours after the hurricane had struck on the last day of September. Air transport, the only means of reaching this stricken area, brings in temporary shelter and cots for the victims of the storm. Bags of rice and wheat, contributed by USAID, and stacks of Army sea rations are loaded aboard the Marine helicopters at Santo Domingo for distribution to the disaster area at Barahona Peninsula. Dominican President Joaquin Balaguer, who requested our assistance, visits the peninsula. Non-agricultural damage is officially estimated at more than $750,000. In this shambles of concrete and wood, flying debris killed nearly 200. Additional hundreds were injured in the violence of the hurricane, and the critical cases are evacuated by air. All up and down the path of the storm, stretching from Barahona to Port-au-Prince in Haiti, 150 miles to the northwest, medical aid is administered and typhus serum given to the survivors. For some, even the hypodermic needle is welcome after the terrors of the storm. In one small community, an Army Special Forces medic treats a little child for inhalation of dirt particles. With the joint efforts of U.S. military forces, U.S. aid agency, and various Dominican Republic relief forces, the emergency is met in the aftermath of Hurricane Inez.